Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ways of Eating, Exploring Food Through History and Culture by Benjamin Aldes Wurgaft and Merry I. Read by Benjamin Aldes Wurgaft. For Gus. Acknowledgments. Many cooks in the kitchen, many people to thank. We bang spoons on pots and pans for our colleagues and friends in food anthropology, food history, and food studies, broadly writ. Rebecca Alsid, Elizabeth Ando, the late Mary Beaudry, Warren Belasco, Katerina Svertka, Johanna Davidson, Dara Goldstein, Rafi Grosklik, Barbara Haber, Ursula Heinzelman, Rachel Loudon, Jill Norman, Heather Paxson, Stephen Chapin, and B. Wilson. Corky, a.k.a. Mary, would also like to acknowledge the support of her early mentor, Julia Child, and Elizabeth David, who helped her along the way. Adam Simha introduced us to knife making. Josh Burson helped us come up with our title over dinner and generously read our book in draft. Carlos Noreña and Thomas David Dubois both read our chapter on ancient empires and offered their expertise. Paul Cosman made valuable suggestions about Rome and Persia, and Jeremiah Dittmar read a very early draft of our chapter on the Industrial Revolution. Thanks, too, to our anonymous readers, and Ben would like to thank his summer school students at Wesleyan, who gave this work a trial run as a textbook. Gus Rankatori, Shannon Supple, Lewis Wurgaft, and Carol Kolsel patiently listened as we discussed this book over years of meals and offered their thoughts. We're so lucky to work with our skilled and thoughtful editor, Kate Marshall, at the University of California Press. Many thanks as well to Chad Attenborough, Catherine Osborne, Francisco Reinking, Alex Don, Kevin Barrett Kane, Ramon Smith, and the whole UC Press team. We dearly miss Sheila Levine, Corky's editor on past UC Press projects, and a force in shaping the academic study of food. Shannon Supple generously contributed illustrations. This book is dedicated to Gus Rankatori in gratitude and love. Lastly, we acknowledge each other. It is sometimes a challenge for a parent and child to work together on a project like this one, to argue over interpretations and to edit one another's words. We feel lucky to have emerged enlivened and unscathed, and to have learned a great deal from one another in the process. Thank you, each other. Introduction. Eating comes before words. A baby takes nourishment before it can speak. Eating and drinking establish our relationship with the surrounding world. We explain that world with words, but we remain dependent upon and vulnerable to the world that feeds us. When conditions are good, we have enough. We become accustomed to finishing a bottle of milk, a cup of coffee, a bowl of rice, and feeling satisfied. But we are never done learning about food. Learning lacks the quality of finality. There is always more to know. Our curiosity reappears like hunger returning. Why does an egg scramble as it does? How does grain ferment into beer? What makes a cookie crumble? The firstness of food in our lives is an understandably old story. First we eat, and then we do everything else, runs a widely quoted remark made by the food writer Mary Frances Kennedy Fisher. This is true enough. Eating doesn't just come before words, it comes before all other human activities within the narrow frame of an individual's life. But beneath this simple statement lies an intricate relationship between sustenance and everything else. Everything else means everything, from grinding corn into masa, to breeding pigs, from creating agricultural subsidies for Japanese rice farmers, to defending Ethiopian cattle grazing land. In other words, there is a great deal of agricultural and food work that prepares the way for eating. And some of this work is not toil in the fields or in kitchens. The everything else in Fisher's line includes the operations of culture, from Greek myths about the origin of the world out of an egg to Dutch still-life paintings depicting opulent oysters and decaying fruit. Many kinds of human activity set the table, as it were, for eating, including creating images and descriptions of what we eat. Representations of food aren't just stories and images. They touch what they represent. Consider a burning fire on a beach in ancient Greece, upon which the hero Odysseus and his men have arranged pieces of sacrificial beef. The heroes of Homer's epics, the Iliad and the Odyssey, sacrifice, roast, and eat a great many animals. But all this carnivorousness was not the reality for ancient Greeks. It was hard to raise so many animals on rocky terrain. Rather, Odysseus's larger-than-life diet reflects aspiration and the prestige ancient Greeks associated with meat. To talk about meat was to describe luxury and high social status, or to connect great deeds with prestigious roasts. In the Odyssey, a number of servants and slaves serve Odysseus's family, raising pigs and goats and cows for the nobles to eat, and a complex social hierarchy determines who enjoys what. But stories about meat helped to maintain meat's prestige, not just in stories told by poets, but also in the daily lives of the gathered audience members. We must reverse M.F.K. Fisher. First, we do everything else, from planting crops to telling stories, and then we can eat. This book is an invitation to be curious about food, and especially to think about food in new ways. The history and anthropology of food show us the strange tales of origin behind familiar tastes and illuminate mysteries within commonplace rituals. But we have to be willing to dig. A ripe strawberry, bursting in your mouth, tells you nothing about the experience of bending down to pick that strawberry in a sun-baked field. It says little about the history of the strawberry's breeding, the emergence of the modern plant from a now-forgotten ancestor through generations of domestication. In a certain sense, a plate of food is the coming together of natural history, the evolutionary stories of the plants and animals we cook, and human history, the ways in which we guide evolution, raise, and cook them. But what hungry eater pauses to inquire into this? Nevertheless, a taste or a smell gives us a place to begin. Tastes and smells are a kind of information telling the body about the food we put in our mouths. Is this safe? Is it nourishing? Will this be good? Our body's needs are simple enough and easily satisfied, but food and drink can also pique our curiosity. We may pause in the supermarket to look at a fruit we've never seen before, perhaps a dragon fruit. We ask a question about a surprising shape at the fish counter. Maybe it's a monkfish. We wonder who eats it and how or if they cook it. Or we look at something familiar, say a bag of granola, and realize we know nothing about how it's made. This book is about the questions that food and drink can compel us to ask. It is about the history of food as a presence in the tastes of the present day. It is also about the way culture guides our hands as we take the next strawberry and cut it with a knife, thinking of a pie. This domesticated strawberry is not natural and wild, but already part of the field of practices and beliefs we call culture. Without human intervention, corn on the cob would just be another kind of grass. This book's title and the opening lines pay homage to John Berger's 1972 book on art history, Ways of Seeing, an adaptation of a television series that introduced many viewers to a new way of thinking about art. Influenced by Marxist cultural criticism, Berger reminded readers that fine art is not simply a heritage of beauty. Everything from the act of painting to hanging paintings in museums tells stories about class, power, and social conflict. Art is a formal exercise in representing and conjuring human experience, but it does not float free of context. Berger sought to unpack the social relations bundled within painting, especially prestigious forms of painting such as modern European portraiture. In a similar way, foods express the ways desire and appetite shape our lives, sometimes dramatically, like gold foil draped over a dish of chicken biryani, or less visibly, as with birds bred over generations to produce more meat faster. The social conflicts and oppressions of the past survive in the cuisine of the present, albeit in greatly transformed ways. So do past patterns of human migration, settlement, trade, war, and travel. We desire food and drink. It's good to acknowledge this and to remember that the body's appetites are not to be degraded as somehow below the neck, an animalistic shame. Our appetites are the heart of our relationship with food, and we can learn much by thinking about them, and even by indulging them. Personal experience is a crucial tool for studying food. But like other human desires, our hunger and thirst can mystify. There are stories in our foods that flavor alone does not tell. Sugar pleases us, but that pleasure says nothing about the history of the colonial plantations where enslaved people once planted and harvested sugarcane. Desire is one of this book's themes. The desire for survival, gruel when the larder is bare. For beloved food, grandmother's noodle soup. For novelties, spices obtained at great risk on the high seas. But power is another. The power Europeans exerted over colonized natives, for example. So is identity, in the sense that our foods and ways of cooking express our cultural and social roots. But identities change over time. This pie recipe may have been in our family for generations, but it hasn't been with us forever, and each baker has added or subtracted something. We eat across cultural boundaries, flipping between family food and that of others. And no cuisine is permanent or stable. Change has always characterized who we are and what we eat, even if we feel culinary anxiety and cling to dishes that we might call traditional or authentic. Human communities migrate or invade each other's lands. New ingredients travel along trade routes. Thus, movement is another one of this book's themes. We also attend to the differences between the clean and the dirty, the edible and the inedible, which shape so many of our food practices, from the question of which plants and animals we call food to how we wash the dishes. Tools and techniques are part of culture too, and so are the bodies of food workers. For generations, women ground maize into corn flour to make tortillas on a flat stone mortar called matate. Their daily motion, the effects on their knees and shoulders, became part of a way of eating. This book consists of a series of historical chapters leading chronologically from the origins of agriculture to the early 21st century, interleaved with vignettes drawn from our observations and ethnographic work in different food worlds. In these chapters and vignettes, we offer specific cases that raise important questions about food and drink. We survey key ideas from cultural anthropology and history that help to explain human food practices and beliefs, but we do not address ourselves solely or primarily to scholars. Our goal is not to encompass the whole history of human foodways, which a short book, or even a very long one, never could. This book reflects our own past research interests and specialties, even our tastes. A note of personal introduction, then. We are your authors. Mary Corky I. White is a cultural anthropologist of Japan and of food and drink in Japan and beyond, who has also worked as a caterer, food journalist, and cookbook writer. Benjamin Ben A. Wurgaft is her son, a writer and historian, who earned a doctorate in European intellectual history while working as a food journalist. Ben is also trained and practiced in the cultural anthropology of science and technology. We both believe that the pleasures of food and drink and the dynamic challenge of food work itself add to and don't distract from the intellectual rewards of studying food. These things are all bound up with each other. The chapters and vignettes in this book reflect our diverse interests, but also the decades of good luck that have allowed us to travel, taste, and benefit from hospitality around the world. From growing up eating kosher dills in Minnesota, to cooking with local herbal blends in Tuscany, to sampling croissant in Tokyo. Some of these vignettes reflect shared experiences, and others are singly authored. While the chapters offer a chronological food history that takes us from the origins of agriculture to the present, the vignettes introduce the cultural anthropology of food, which seeks the expressions of meaning in food practice. At the heart of cultural anthropology is observation. The anthropologist brings a trained and purposeful naivete to fieldwork, open to everything and to all possible significance. We all bring filters and preconceptions to every observation, but the best way to work with that bias is first to acknowledge it, and then to cast our awareness wide and deep. You never know which details or senses are significant. A man carries a grocery bag on the subway, and it threatens to split, carrots sticking out of holes in its side. The sound of church bells draws black-garmented women in for services, while their men sit in an outdoor cafe, drinking coffee. A bin smells like mellow fermentation or exudes the stench of rotting garbage. Historical research often begins in an archive and rarely involves fieldwork, but it shares an important feature with cultural anthropology. While historians all have their ideological and methodological biases, we work with evidence just as anthropologists do. And we have to be open to the possibility that evidence will make us reformulate our views. In the history and anthropology of food, there are different kinds of questions, each answered with their appropriate kinds of methods and evidence. There are empirical questions we hope to answer, and there are theoretical explanations we can hope to offer. And part of the art of the practice is becoming clear about which is which. We refine our questions and learn which methods and evidence will help us to answer them. Anthropology almost always starts with research conducted in the contemporary world, but it often plunges us into the past of a community. Thus, a food anthropologist might start by sitting on a stool at a ramen stall in Tokyo, then move on to the origins of the dashi that infuses ramen broth, and to Japanese concerns about the future of the waters, the migrations of fish, and the farming of seaweed. History, by contrast, is the study of change over time, and food history often starts with research into the letters, diaries, or physical evidence of past generations of cooks and eaters. Cookbooks and menus are material for the cultural historian of food. Shards of pottery serve archaeologists who look at cooking practices. But when we ask how past actors cooked and ate and made meaning of these acts, we often reach for the tools of cultural anthropologists, for we know that cultural practices infuse and shape everything from tilling a field to setting a table. As we begin, keep these questions in mind. What can we aspire to know about food? What steps should we take to learn? What can our meals tell us about the structure of our communities? Who are the farmers? Who are the cooks? Who makes the pots that dinner cooks in? Who makes the wine? And who does the dishes? Vignette 1. Duccio's Eden. Down an interminable dirt road through the woods, we call, "Duccio! Signore Fantani!" And finally hear, "Si, si," from what looks like a patch of brush. We've been trying to find Duccio for over an hour. We're near Siena, not far from Florence, and we know Duccio Fantani from the farmer's market in the nearby town of Castellina, where he sells herbs. We've been dusting those herbs on pork, into soup, and on roasted potatoes and vegetables for weeks. Now we've come to see where they grow. We've been searching for Duccio for a long time, long enough that some members of our party have despaired of actually finding him. Their hopes have refocused on breaking off for a Campari. But now Duccio insistently beckons us down a hill of scratchy bushes, down the tracks made by his herd of donkeys, and into piles of their shit. Some of us, wearing sandals instead of proper shoes, end up with dung caked under our toenails. Duccio keeps waving. Does Duccio grow the herbs he sells? As he leads us across the hillsides where coriander, rosemary, and fennel grow, we slowly learn that the answer is yes and no. He's not a forager. If a forager is someone who gathers what grows with no human interference at all. Nor is he a gleaner, gathering the aftermath of formal harvesting. He's more an encourager of his crops, who sometimes propagates herbs from last year's seeds, though most of what he gathers is from volunteer plants. This is not a farm, and although Duccio and his team remain in one place year-round, he isn't an herb farmer. He occasionally builds fences to keep the donkeys away from the best herb beds, but he gives the impression that the fences are a little too infrastructural by his lights. Slight, with a gray ponytail and piercing eyes, he looks like a wood gnome. He points out clusters of sprouts nestled next to tree stumps and weedy mixtures of herbs, not in serried rows or homogeneous patches. He calls out, "Coriandolo, rosmarino, fiera greco, elicriso," the same list of ingredients featured in his mixed spice jars, which he labels "arumi da cucini del Chianti," the scents of Chianti cooking. Is this an ungainly Garden of Eden in which nature brings forth its riches sua sponte? Again, yes and no. Duccio thinks of himself as the happy bystander of the nearly spontaneous growth of juniper, catnip, wild fennel, and helichrysum. But there is some strategy and husbandry involved. He manages water, harboring it through the dry season and doling it out only as necessary. The donkeys that trample and run paths of their own through the property also fertilize the soil. As we carefully step our way across lavender and rosemary, it's possible to imagine that this is a model of the origins of sedentary agriculture. If Duccio built a few more fences and planted a few more seeds, gave in to the impulse to expand his operation, a farm is what he'd have. Despite meeting the criteria, he does not covet the bio appellation, the official trademark of organic foods in Italy. He says, "Perché troppo costoso," it's too pricey to buy one's way into authorized purity by going through the bureaucratic process. His jar labels read, "Genuino clandestino," advertising his resistance to the stamp of official approval that might eventually boost his revenue, but which offends his countercultural sensibility and politics. His workplace, such as it is, radiates ambivalence about capitalism. Walking across an overgrown field, we reach a ramshackle wooden structure, late afternoon sunlight streaming through the breaks between planks. Bushels of herbs lie in racks in a drying room. The scent of lavender stops us in our tracks. The next room is like a little alchemist's laboratory where Duccio's assistants make herbal oils, cordials, and extracts. There is a pre-agricultural, pre-industrial aura about the whole domain, but Duccio understands that it takes artisanal processing to unlock everything herbs offer. It's a reminder that even before agriculture, it took technique and skill to take our sustenance from nature. Not to mention that the oils, cordials, and extracts yield a better margin than the herbs themselves, and in a gentle paradox, provide financial support for Duccio's minimally interventionist anti-agribusiness project. Chapter 1. Nature and Culture in the Origins of Agriculture. Why do we eat what we eat? Charles Darwin, in his 1871 The Descent of Man, speculated that agriculture, which is a hybrid word coming from agri, Greek for field, and culture, from the Latin cultivare, to nurture, divides the state of savagery from that of civilization. Certainly, the practice of agriculture normally goes hand in hand with many familiar aspects of civilization. A system of property rights, fixed dwelling places, complex forms of social organization beyond the family, and so forth. It may have even helped usher them into being. Darwin imagined a simple accident at the root of farming, in which a fruit tree's seeds happened to fall on a heap of refuse. We can be certain that the real origins of plant and animal domestication and agriculture were more complex, dependent not only on observing happy natural accidents, but also on coordinated human action. This chapter examines the shift from hunting and gathering to agriculture, an unsettled transition over which biologists, paleontologists, archaeologists, and anthropologists still argue. If the human species has existed in its modern form for somewhere between 200,000 and 400,000 years, depending on what benchmarks for speciation we use, then humans have practiced agriculture for only a small fraction of our history, beginning around the year 11,000 BCE. Hominid use of controlled fire for cooking seems to have preceded the emergence of our species. Thus, agriculture came after fire. Agriculture's advent coincided with the end of the Pleistocene, the last ice age, and the beginning of the Holocene, the period we still occupy today. In the early 21st century, many observers of climate change have renamed the Holocene the Anthropocene to capture the effects of humans and our technology on the environment. But our effects on the natural world arguably began with agriculture itself, one of the most consequential developments of what is often called the Neolithic Revolution, in which our species started to make and use tools extensively. In a historical irony, many of the earliest fertile areas that nurtured the transition to agriculture are now degraded. Much of Iraq and Iran, for example, has become unsuitable for farming, and the Sahel in Africa is plagued by drought and famine. Agriculture means tending to and changing the plant and animal species that flourish in a given acre of land, so that we can eat a higher percentage of the biomass produced on that acre. This definition is capacious enough to include the large-scale industrial farming practices of the early 21st century, as well as what some anthropologists call intensification, the simple effort to encourage certain species to prevail in an area and to discourage others from flourishing. It also includes animal husbandry without sedentary plant agriculture. Whatever its scale, Agriculture begins with selecting the plant and animal species most appropriate for our dietary needs. Relatively few of the plant species around us are edible. Of the about 200,000 wild plant species that were present around 11,000 BCE, we have domesticated only a few hundred. Our primary crop plants are the domesticated descendants of a relative handful of wild ancestors that, because of their nutritional and physical properties, attracted early agriculturalists. Similarly, the animals we eat, or that yield dairy and eggs, descend from wild ancestors that seemed suitable for domestication, often because they were sociable, mild-tempered, and lived in a herd or pack structure that made them amenable to human authority. We use, for food, labor, or transportation, only a handful of the Earth's some 148 large terrestrial mammal species. While it is true that agriculture was the first step in the human effort to bring nature under control for our benefit, some authors have viewed the process from the reverse angle. If humans benefit from being able to eat a higher percentage of the plants and animals on a given acre of land, so do the species they cultivate, because humans act like bumblebees, aiding their reproduction and spreading them across the paths of human migration. The result is that these species guarantee their survival. Becoming domesticated is a successful adaptation in evolutionary terms. In the early 21st century, a dozen plant species account for 80% of the tonnage we grow each year. Wheat, corn, rice, barley, sorghum, soybean, potato, manioc, sweet potato, sugarcane, sugar beet, and banana. And some 73% of the calories we consume globally come from rice, wheat, corn, and manioc alone. These are the plants humans have come to specialize in eating. Most interestingly, these human crop plants have been with us for a long time on the scale of recorded history. The modern period, approximately the 15th century Common Era to the present, has not seen the domestication of any major new staple crop plants, nor of any new important livestock species. Whether one views the history of agriculture from the perspective of the farmer or the farmed, however, it is important to note the recursive nature of the process. In modifying nature, we modify ourselves. While humans are remarkably flexible in their ability to derive nutrition from a limited range of foods, in a famous example, the Inuit living in the Arctic Circle have thrived on whale meat and little else. We have become entirely dependent on the availability of a small set of specific plants and animals for our sustenance. Without our monocultures, we would need to find new subsistence strategies or return to old ones. Of course, agriculture is much more than an arrangement between Homo sapiens and the plant and animal species that volunteered to become part of our biological infrastructure. Agriculture has touched everything, from social organization to language to religion. 100 rituals from cultures around the world, such as sprinkling water from a gourd to encourage rain, or sacrificing livestock so the gods will make plants grow, attest to the importance of the annual cycle of growth, death, and rebirth, and to the centrality of agriculture in human imaginations. Even the more abstract beliefs of historically later monotheistic religions, such as Christianity, have been traced back to the importance of the agricultural cycle. Agriculture did not simply become a mechanism for human adaptation, subsistence, and flourishing, but a focus for human cultural and social development, just as gathering and hunting had been. Subsistence quickly becomes as much about culture as it is about calories. In his classic book, The Raw and the Cooked, the anthropologist Claude Lévi-Strauss thought of cooking as a way of mediating between that which humans make or control, the world of culture, and that which we ultimately cannot control, the world of nature. Levi-Strauss built a system of anthropological thought called structuralist anthropology out of such binary distinctions, finding evidence to support his claims in both pre-modern and modern human cultures. According to structuralism, meaning accrues through oppositions and differences, such as the play of differences between a basket of raw tubers and their counterparts that have baked underneath hot rocks. One of the lessons of structuralism for the anthropology of food has been that the meanings of what we eat are not fixed and can change as our ability to produce differences changes. Thus, new tools and techniques for preparing food have implications for culture, even as culture transforms our tools and techniques in turn. Another lesson is that the structures of meaning that govern our lives are largely impersonal. We may have our personal associations with specific foods, but the meaning of the opposition between the raw and the cooked is larger than our preferences and carries a meaning that we cannot dispute, just as there's something impersonal about the generally agreed-upon meaning of words like cat or night. Foodways become a system of meanings we live in, akin to a language. They respond to the human desire to organize and give meaning to the world as much as they respond to our need for nutrition. The Neolithic Revolution saw an increase in sedentism, settled living, the manufacture of increasingly refined stone tools, and pottery and the adoption of agriculture, the latter being a very gradual stop-and-start affair ongoing at multiple sites of human settlement. In some cases, a given community would take a step towards agriculture and then a step away, only to return to agriculture again. The reasons agriculture began around 11,000 BCE are the subject of much debate, but there is a strong consensus about that time frame itself. As a miniature ice age ended, glaciers retreated, temperatures stabilized at a somewhat warmer point, and more of the Earth's land became ecologically inviting. Wild grasses spread across the land, grasses that humans later domesticated as crops. Many disagreements regarding the origins of agriculture seem to result from the different types of evidence used by investigators. Human bones and teeth may tell one story about what was eaten and how it was acquired, whereas stone tools, pottery, and other artifacts suggest others. Seed residue and other preserved plant matter, including phytoliths or plant stones, crystals formed of calcium oxalate or calcium carbonate within the epidermal cells of plants or between those cells, and then preserved in the soil after a plant decays, tell their own tales. Radiocarbon dating has been one of our best tools for decades, and more recently, genetic sequencing techniques have deepened our understanding of the slow pace at which animal and plant species were domesticated. But expanding the types of evidence available to us has hardly quelled disagreement and led to a singular consensus about agriculture's emergence. There may, in fact, be no single explanation of why we slowly ceased to be hunters and gatherers and became farmers and herders, or of how agriculture spread worldwide rather than remaining concentrated in the few geographic centers where it seems to have developed independently. The Near East, certain parts of China, mainly the Yangtze and Yellow River valleys, Mesoamerica, the Peruvian highlands, and Eastern North America. When we think of the word infrastructure, as in the roads and bridges and waterways we depend upon, we must also think of the biological infrastructure of our fields of crops. All of our accomplishments as a civilization depend on the foundation of this bio-infrastructure. And yet agriculture was not an inevitable answer to the question of how to get food. When viewed from the short-term perspective of most hunter-gatherer communities, agriculture is a surprisingly bad idea. Anthropological research into the lives of the few remaining communities of hunter-gatherers in the modern world has shown that they often work fewer hours per week when compared to their agricultural neighbors, while enjoying at least as many calories for their labors. Bones and teeth recovered from ancient campsites and burial grounds suggest that early hunter-gatherers were better nourished, physically larger, and longer lived than the first farmers. While an agricultural community may induce a given acre of land to produce more edible biomass per year than does, say, an untamed forest, it requires a massive expenditure of effort, plowing, planting, tending, harvesting, to achieve this result. If abundant sources of food in the form of fruits, nuts, tubers, and animal prey are available, it is cheaper from the viewpoint of the individual to simply exploit those resources. The attractions of the hunting and gathering lifestyle may explain why some human communities reverted to these practices after initially adopting agriculture. They may have only adopted it due to shortages within their hunting and foraging territories. The idea of a sudden and decisive switch from hunting and gathering to farming has been widely disproven. It appears that in many parts of the world, there were long periods in which both styles of life were practiced, with the balance slowly tipping in favor of agriculture over many generations. Agriculture was not a choice our distant ancestors made, it seems, but a process they got caught up in. And yet we became an agricultural species, one that does not simply inhabit ecological niches, but constructs them. Explanations for the early adoption of agriculture have included the simple inventor theory, the idea that individuals observed the ways plants grew from wild seeds and then replicated the process themselves under controlled conditions. There were also settlement theories, according to which the practices of living in permanent settlements, made possible by the slow withdrawal of the last ice age, made agriculture more attractive. Other theories have used accumulative personality types, technological innovation, the need to maximize a shrinking resource base under conditions of desertification, the emergence of the idea of property, and even the development of religion as explanatory mechanisms. And this list merely scratches the surface. There are also theories that make population pressure the driver for agriculture's development, at least in some parts of the world. Most population pressure models are variations on the following. Agriculture may not be better than hunting and gathering when it comes to satisfying the needs of an individual, but it can be superior when viewed from the perspective of a community, and especially so for larger and more settled human communities. Farming can yield greater amounts of food at once, and thus allow communities to create food reserves and to feed more individuals. An increase in food supply often leads to an increase in population growth, an observation formalized by the English political economist Thomas Robert Malthus in the late 18th century. According to Malthus, population growth always stays ahead of advances in agricultural yields, and population pressure can, under certain conditions, hold constant even as agriculture intensifies and becomes more productive. It follows that as communities increase in size, it becomes increasingly rewarding for them to invest time in agriculture. Another feature of many population growth theories is that sedentary agriculture gave rise to an increase in birth rates. Mothers living within settled communities have been able to have children at closer intervals than their hunter-gatherer counterparts who kept on the move, and who consequently could care for a smaller number of children at a time. Normally, mothers in nomadic communities wait until a child is 3 or 4 years old and can walk a long way on its own before having another. But even if the intensifying effect of population pressure is relatively uncontroversial, the claim that population pressure resulted in the development of agriculture in the first place seems unsubstantiated by the available evidence. Archaeologists have not found evidence that population pressure increased prior to the adoption of agriculture in any given human settlement. Researchers have found what may be the earliest agricultural site in the world at Abu Huraira in modern Syria, where there is evidence of planting as early as 11,500 BCE. Such settlements were established after what is known as the Younger Dryas glaciation event, which began around 12,800 BCE and brought over 1,000 years of cold, shattering the ecosystems whose stability enabled human settlement. It seems likely that the Younger Dryas postponed early experiments in agricultural living around the world. The most extensive evidence of uninterrupted early agriculture has been found in three general areas. The Near East, where agriculture took hold by 9,000 BCE. China's Yellow River Valley, with a starting date of around 7,500 BCE. And the Peruvian highlands in Mesoamerica, where the first signs of agriculture date to around 6,500 BCE. It is important to note that the dates trusted by individual archaeologists and anthropologists vary and are likely to change as new discoveries are made. In considering the sites where agriculture succeeded most visibly, we should bear in mind the remarkable coincidences of factors that helped it to succeed. In the Near East, factors contributing to the success of agriculture included the Mediterranean's climate, with its mild and moist winters and long hot summers. This produced plants hardy enough to survive the dry season and then grow after the coming of rain, but which, because they were annuals, did not create much indigestible woody mass. Their one-year cycle of life meant that they put more of their caloric energy into producing seeds, which humans could eat. While our planet features multiple zones of Mediterranean climate, including parts of North and South America's west coasts, as well as parts of the southern coast of Australia, the Near East had both vastly more plants suitable for domestication, as well as more large mammals similarly suitable for human use. The major crops in the Fertile Crescent included einkorn and emmer wheat, two very early cultivated wheat varietals, as well as barley, lentils, peas, chickpeas, flax, one of the few early domesticates grown and used for clothing rather than for food, and bitter vetch, whose seeds resemble red lentils but must be purged of their bitterness in baths of water before humans can comfortably consume them. The process of agricultural adoption appears to have been completed by 6,000 BCE. Notably, in the Fertile Crescent, animal and plant agriculture had complementary effects. While one reason to engage in animal agriculture is meat, and another is milk, a milk or egg-producing animal will yield many times its calories over its life than one slaughtered for meat, by domesticating animals, we realized another benefit: their labor power, often crucial for agriculture. Notably, in much of Africa, herders domesticated animals and practiced nomadic animal agriculture, traveling with their herds long before anyone domesticated plants. The most important crops in the Americas were the so-called three sisters, maize, beans, and squash, which were grown throughout Mesoamerica by 1500 BCE, and long before then in many areas. Agriculture appears to have first begun in Mexico and Peru, with one archaeological dig in the Mexican state of Oaxaca indicating that squash may have been domesticated around the same time as crops in the Near East. R.S. McNeish, one of the most important early figures in the scientific effort to understand the origins of agriculture, found sites in the modern Mexican state of Tamaulipas where chili peppers and gourds, as well as squash and beans, were cultivated between 7,000 and 5,500 BCE. In Tehuacan, in south-central Mexico, The same crops as in Tamaulipas, plus maize, amaranth, and avocado, could be traced to around 5,000 to 3,500 BCE. Dogs and turkeys were both domesticated as food sources. Maize seems to have been first grown in lower and wetter regions and was gradually adapted to higher and drier latitudes. In the Peruvian highlands, beans and chilies have been found dated to about 6,000 BCE. The most important difference between early agriculture in the Americas and in the Near East may have been the absence of animal power in the former. While smaller animals were indeed domesticated at the Mexican and Peruvian sites of early agriculture, they were not the larger 100-plus pound species that proved useful in farming efforts in the Near East. It seems likely that China's Yangtze River Valley was the first site where rice was domesticated, producing something that began to look like contemporary white rice out of the wild ancestral plant. Evidence suggests that this may have first taken place as early as 11,000 BCE, placing the origins of agriculture in China in the same relation to the Younger Dryas event as the parallel events in the Near East. All of the important crops in China were local domesticates. Foxtail millet, broomcorn millet — the Yangtze River Valley seems to have run on a millet-based subsistence economy at some point between 5,000 BCE and 3,000 BCE.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.